Hallo iedereen, welkom bij Dutch & Go. Today I want to talk to you about the NT2 staatsexamen, program 1, program 2, specifically the speaking part, and what you can do to prepare yourself for the exam and not feel maybe discouraged, but rather feel motivated and empowered. Let's go! So, first of all, this is a follow-up video on an introductory video that I made about the NT2 staatsexamen generally, in which I explain the exam and how it works. And then I also made another video in which I explained how you can practice the speaking part for the exam and how you can practice and prepare yourself specifically to train the speaking part of the exam at home. So today I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about some things that you can do before the exam, some things to remember during the exam as well. Bear in mind as well, this exam, the speaking part of this exam specifically, is quite different from lots of other international European language exams, such as TELC, for example. And that, of course, makes it also quite a difficult and specific exam to prepare for. No matter what your level is, please bear in mind, always, always practice specifically this exam if you want to take it. Don't assume because you think that you have B1 or B2, or because you have another certificate that says you have B1 or B2, that is enough to pass this exam. You really, really need to practice this exam. And then ideally use the books. If you want to do program 1, use the books vooruit. Or if you want to do program 2, the finale. I would absolutely highly recommend you to use those books if you want to practice that exam. Finally, I also personally have some gripes and issues with the exam as a teacher. I personally think that the exam has some substantial problems, not necessarily mistakes or whatever, but just some problems that I think I would like to maybe address in another video. But for that, I would really like to hear also from you in the comment section. What do you think? Is that something that you would be interested in, to hear my perspective as a teacher on the NT2 exam? I know it's not an often discussed topic because exams are these sort of huge institutions that nobody ever puts into question. And I think it's kind of important to do so because they often set the bar for what you have to know and what is expected of you. And they often pretend to be neutral, but oftentimes they're not. And specifically this NT2 exam is definitely not neutral and indeed has some very problematic aspects. So I would love to hear from you if you think that that is a good idea, and then I'll make a video about it. What you can do before the exam to prepare yourself right before the exam. First of all, your nerves, general anxiousness, nervousness, stress levels might be an issue. In order to deal with that the best as possible and in order to not let that affect your results, I would absolutely recommend that you do everything that you can to be in a relaxed headspace before you enter the building. So whatever you need to do, try to do that. Whether that means getting up in the morning and going for a run, listening to a funny podcast, reading a comic book, watching a cute YouTube video of a dog and a cat cuddling together, whatever you need to do in order to feel relaxed and comfortable, do that. Listening to mindfulness podcasts, do that. I don't necessarily recommend you to do a lot of things in Dutch before the exam starts. Think about it like this. You've already put in the hours. You've already put in the work. You've already trained. You've already, you know, practiced so many hours. So basically, that training will come in as the exam starts. If you feel like you really need to review certain things, which I discourage you from doing that, then do that. But generally, just try to get in as relaxed of a state as possible. Just so that your stress level doesn't really affect your results, or affects your results as little as possible. Don't forget to practice, of course, in the weeks and months before the exam, using the books that I already mentioned. And if you can, just also generally before the exam, save up some money. Even if money is an issue, try to save up some money for some private classes, just so you can have some highly individual private feedback, which you wouldn't get when you do group classes or when you do self-study. I think you know, paying for individual private classes and the feedback that you get from that will be extremely valuable to you in order for you to get a good result and in order to get the most out of this exam. Because yeah, I just think that individual feedback is the best kind of possible feedback that you could want in this specific type of exam situation. And well, maybe one more final thing, not only feedback, but also train with a timer and train repeatedly, and maybe also record yourself and listen back to your own recordings. I promise you, it's horrible because nobody likes the sound of their own voice, but believe me when I say that it will be a revelation and extremely helpful to hear what kind of mistakes you make when you speak during the exam. When it comes to during the exam, just try to stay calm, and as you go through the speaking exercises, which basically start automatically in the beginning of the exam and they just continue until the end, try to stay calm and don't think too much about the 20 seconds or 30 seconds that you've just spoken. Just accept it for what it was and move on to the next thing, and don't think, ah, that was not good, I didn't like that, I made a mistake there. Don't think about that. Move on, say it, drop the mic like it's hot, and move on to the next thing, like also jazz players would. You know, you go into a studio, you record your thing, you drop the mic, and you move on. That's basically the approach that you need in order to conquer this Mount Everest of an exam. Because otherwise you're just going to be distracted when the next questions start, you're not going to be fully focused, you need to let it go as soon as the speaking task is over, and then move on to the next question, move on to the next exercise. Another tip is to read the instructions as carefully as possible and to really look at what it is that they require from you. If they say give two reasons, give twee redenen, then give two reasons, make sure that you give both. Or if they just ask for an explanation why you think something, why you choose something, and they don't really give an indication of how many, then just come up with one, and come up with only one, but a good one. Yeah. So make sure that you always look carefully what it is exactly that they require of you and adjust your answers accordingly. That way there's no confusion and you just know exactly where you'll be going and heading to. Also keep in mind, you can think about whatever you want. The examinators are not interested in your own personal opinion for the situations that they've created. They're putting you, like a pawn, into several situations, places, contexts, or whatever, and they're just letting you respond, react to that in these kind of situations. You don't have to do that from your own personal perspective. If you feel like that the situations can be quite foreign to you, which, you know, depending on your background, might be, if maybe you're an art student, for example, or your focus is just a different one than the job-centered approach that this exam mostly takes, the very practical focus that this exam mostly has, then, you know, just maybe imagine an uncle or an aunt or someone in your family who leads a more maybe traditional sort of standard life than maybe you do. Or if that's not possible, try to imagine as if you were in a movie and really try to visualize the role that you're supposed to play. Try to vision your surroundings, the office that you're in. If you're at work, by the way, well then maybe you can think about work comedies such as Parks and Recreation, The Office, or in Flemish Het Eiland. What happens in these kind of situations for these series? Maybe that's something that can help you. All of these things can really, really help you to imagine yourself in that situation and to come up with a good idea. Another thing that is really important to remember is that you can make the exam work for you and the vocabulary that you know, to a certain degree, of course. But when someone is asking for your ideas, your opinion, your suggestions, it doesn't really matter whether that's your personal idea, your personal opinion. You just have to give something. It just has to be appropriate for that context. Also, in the correction criteria, or in the evaluation criteria rather, They're never mentioning anywhere that you're not allowed to give an appropriate answer, but that is maybe a little bit more absurd or illogical to some people. If it makes sense in the context, if it's an appropriate answer in the context, then they have to evaluate it as such, even if it is a bit more absurd, funny, weird, or whatever. As long as it makes sense in the context, it's fine. Which also means that you can use words and manipulate the bits that you have to say, the reaction that you have to say, to the in the direction of words and things that you know. If someone is asking you for cool gifts for your boss, it doesn't really matter. Just use something, just give a suggestion for things that you know. Maybe try to imagine what that boss looks like, what he or she likes to do in their spare time, and give some suggestions. But they don't have to correspond to your own personal opinion. If someone is asking you for opinion on whether they should go back to work after having had a baby or not, it doesn't really matter what your own personal ideas are about whether women should go back to work after having had a baby or not. That is not relevant. Come up with something and argue with, no matter whether it's something that you find maybe weird or strange that you would never say in your own private personal life. It doesn't matter. You just have to be able to argue it well. Another important tip is that you should rather wait to start speaking and maybe take 1 or 2 seconds to think about what you're going to say, and then start speaking. Rather, wait after the beep has started, maybe wait 1 or 2 seconds, and then try to speak cohesively, then immediately start speaking, but have it kind of be all jumbled up and go like, I think that, no. Rather wait 1 or 2 seconds, think about what it is that you're going to say, compose yourself, and then start speaking. That's just going to result in a much better end result. And finally, I cannot emphasize this enough, just be kind to yourself. Don't be too hard on yourself. This is a difficult exam with some very highly specific, highly precise vocabulary speaking exercises that is just not easy to tackle for anyone. If you're struggling, I see you, I feel you, and well, corona-proof feel you, but still feel you, and I totally know where you're coming from. And believe me when I say you're not alone, and many people before you have done it, and you can do it too. Finally, some things to keep in mind. Even if you don't manage to say everything that is required of you to say, as long as you speak the full 20 seconds or 30 seconds, however long you're supposed to speak, it's still all right as long as you don't stop. Imagine, for example, you're supposed to give your opinion on something and give 2 reasons why that is your opinion. You have 30 seconds to respond. All right. So you start speaking, but you stop after 15 seconds and you've only given 1 reason. Then that would result in losing some points. However, if you speak, you give your advice, and you give 1 reason, but the clock runs out on you and it's at the end and the 30 seconds are up, then they would have to evaluate the whole exercise as if you had given 2 reasons, okay? Because they would presume that under normal circumstances, you would still be able to give a second reason. I hope that this little rule when it comes to the correction and evaluation of your exam, that makes sense. I really think that's an important thing to know. So don't worry, even if you didn't manage to say everything that you wanted to say, as long as you manage to speak the full 20 or 30 seconds, that's good. Having said all of that, of course, do train to make sure that you manage to time yourself to say everything that is required of you to say. That way you're definitely in the safe zone. But still, if that happens during the exam and you don't manage to say everything that is required of you to say, but you speak the full 20 or 30 seconds, you should be okay. Another thing to keep in mind with regards to the correction of the exam and the final evaluation of the exam, keep in mind that they can only deduct so many points for a certain amount of mistakes. They can only deduct a certain amount of points for sentence construction. They can only deduct a certain amount of points for not choosing the right word. I think out of 103, it's 6 points. So basically, after you've lost those 6 points, there are no more points to deduct because you didn't choose the right word. So in that sense, I think this exam is fair-ish when it comes to that aspect, because you know there's only a certain amount of points that you can lose. You cannot continue losing points for not knowing certain words after you've lost the maximum of 6 points. There are limits to that. So that is, of course, the good news. But of course, the bad news is that I would still highly recommend that you study as much vocabulary as possible and prepare yourself as much as possible, because of course, you know, the less points you lose, the better for everyone. So that's it. That was my video with tips and things that you should keep in mind, know about before the exam, during the exam, and after the exam. I would also highly recommend to look at the correction models as they are mentioned on the NT2 website, because I promise you that will be tremendously helpful and will just understand or help you understand a little bit better exactly what it is that they're looking for, how they're evaluating it, and what it is that is considered to be a serious mistake and what is considered to be a less serious mistake. All right, don't get too hung up on your own mistakes. Mistakes are normal. It's not because you made some mistakes that you're going to automatically fail the exam, etc. But do train this exam a lot. I hope this video was helpful. Thank you so much for watching. Leave a comment in the comment box down below if you have any other questions about the speaking part of the NT2 exam that I have left unanswered in these last two videos. Let me know if you have any further questions, and if you would be interested in a video in which I talk about my personal issues as a language teacher with this exam. I would love to hear if that is something that you would like to see as well. Thank you so much for watching. Tot de volgende keer. And